it's now my particular pleasure and honour to welcome our founder, benefactor, and our director, Professor Alexander Cambitoglou, to address us on the prehistory of the Australian Archaeological Institute at Athens, a longer version of which I hope you've also found on your chairs this evening. Welcome, Professor Cambitoglou.
Your Excellency, Madam Chancellor, and President of our Institute. Your Excellency, Mr. Christopoulos, Ambassador of Peace. Your Excellency, Mr. Suleiman, Ambassador of Syria. Your Excellency, Mr. Diakoglu, High Commissioner of Cyprus. Ladies and gentlemen, the creation of the Australian Archaeological Institute at Athens in 1918 was not a sudden event. It was the result of efforts of a number of people that take us back to the years that followed the Second World War, and the creation of the Department of Archaeology in the University of Sydney in 1948 by the late Professor A.B. Trendle, a classical archaeologist of international repute, who had been professor of Greek and curator of the Nicholson Museum in this university since 1939. The creation of the Department of Archaeology was the result of a development which began in 1860 with Charles Nicholson, who gave his collection of classical and Near Eastern antiquities to the university. In 1954, Professor Trendle resigned from the university and moved to Canberra to become Master of the University House in the Australian National University. His departure was a blow to the newly founded department and to classical archaeology, which was not taught after that in Sydney until 1962 when I arrived in this country. Unlike the department, which is comparatively recent, the Nicholson Museum has a respectable age for a university collection by any Western standards. Since its creation, it has been enriched by gifts and purchases, and I will especially mention here the Nicholson Hermes, given by the sons of Sir Charles Nicholson in 1934. I knew, of course, before my arrival in Sydney at the end of 1961 of the existence of the Nicholson Museum, but I recall distinctly the feeling of depression that I experienced when I first crossed this entrance door. Originals and plastic arts covered with dust and cobwebs were all thrown together in three rooms under the old Fisher Library. This was the state of the Department of Archaeology in the Nicholson Museum in the beginning of 1962, and the prospects were not bright, especially since the news that had reached the university was that Professor Stewart, the head of the department, was seriously ill at his home near Bathurst. Soon after, Professor Stewart died, and I was appointed acting head of the Department of Archaeology and acting curator of the Nicholson Museum. In 1963, the partly endowed chair of Near Eastern Archaeology, which had been occupied by the late Professor Stewart for only a few months, was frozen, and the university chair in archaeology was advertised in 1963, for which I doubt and was appointed that year. The Department of Archaeology and the Nicholson Museum were in chaotic state when I was appointed acting head in 1962. But there were some encouraging signs. Firstly, in 1961, the academic staff had been increased to 3. Secondly, the museum had acquired an assistant photographer and a conservator. And thirdly, there was in the university a good archaeological library due to Professor Trendle's efforts. Above all, there was the fine collection of the museum which could be used for teaching purposes. With the help of an able young staff and an understanding administration, especially Professor Bill O'Neill, who was chairman of the professorial board and later on deputy vice chancellor, a new course was planned in 1962. Full pass, honors, and postgraduate courses were gradually introduced during the next few years. My opinion from the beginning was that by virtue of our museum, our library, and the tradition of the university, the department should concentrate only on classical and Near Eastern archaeology. Following Trendle's departure, classical archaeology had not been taught for 8 years until I arrived in Sydney at the end of 1961, and I considered it my duty to restore the subject to its former position. As part of the reorganization, I convinced Professor O'Neill that the second classical archaeologist was needed, and with his help, I secured Dr. J.R. Green's appointment in 1964 as senior lecturer, who later on was promoted to an associate professor. Dr. Green proved to be an able lecturer and a distinguished scholar. Concurrently, the policy was introduced of inviting distinguished scholars from overseas as visiting lecturers. As a result of these efforts, the numbers of students increased, and in 1962, the students of the Archaeological Society was created. In 1973, I secured the appointment of Dr. Jean-Paul Becker as a lecturer, later on senior lecturer and associate professor. His selection was made because he was a good young scholar and had the right views about the importance of foreign languages in the discipline of classics, alas, a very weak point in the education system of this country.